and welcome. And you've probably, or by now you've heard a lot about the senior capstone, and I hope that this will all help you for your own project if you're a junior and you'll be doing this next year. Or at least I hope you'll be a lot more prepared than I was, because when I first heard about this, I was so stressed out. I already had so much to focus on, not just other classes, but also juggling my home lives here and in Fort Collins. And I'd also decided to try out for the fall play, which had become a whole nother obstacle. But I wanted to make the most out of this experience. I wanted to pick something that felt less like just another mandatory project and more like taking something that I was already passionate about just one step further. So I chose to center it around art. And I've been an artist for 5 years now, but art has impacted me my entire life. It spurs my imagination and gives me a feeling of adventure the same way that a book or a movie could. So there, I had my passion, but now I had to pick a virtue. And when I thought about the kind of person that I wanted to be, and what kind of virtue could be cultivated through an art-related experience, I realized that I don't really connect with others all that often when it comes to art. I tend to do it for myself, and if other people like it, then that's cool too. But I wanted to find a way to bless others with it. And I came up with the idea to start an art club, which would bring together people of all ages and mediums and skill levels together to grow together as artists. There are so many benefits to bringing art to a community. It not only fosters creativity, but also individuality, and helps people get their emotions out in a very healthy way. You can paint, draw, or ink anything that you can imagine, and anything from your medium to your canvas type to your brush strokes can be used to express the way that you feel about the world or who you are as a person. And by taking the time to view the way other people see things from their perspective and to share your perspective with the rest of the world, we're able to bridge gaps between whole cultures. That's what I wanted for the club, and what I hope to start after the break when it was supposed to launch. But I realized that if I was going to be doing this for a whole community, I shouldn't be doing it alone. So I asked Ashi Vihil if she would help me start the club, and also if she'd help me to do an art collaboration, because I wanted to learn how to work with people and to collaborate with them. And we came together with very similar ideas for the club itself, but very different ideas for the artwork. And we both had to learn how to get rid of some of our preconceptions and come up with something that really blended both of our styles. And it took a while because we had so much stuff going on, but she just finished a sketch and I'm working on the rest at home. But while she was still working on that, and we had realized that the club was going to take a lot more to get moving, I realized that I probably wouldn't have a lot to show for the first semester. So I planned a trip down to Canvas and Cocktails, a place downtown where people from all over the city come together and learn how to paint a piece from a variety that you have to choose from. And I thought this would not be my thing at all, because I don't paint, and I don't like being told what to do when it comes to creativity, because I feel like that's besides the point. But when we started, it was actually a lot of fun. We paid for the materials, and we sat down and followed along with the instructor. But the instructions were not as rigid as I thought they'd be, and everyone's piece turned out completely unique. And even though mine was definitely not the best, I was actually proud of myself for being able to kind of try out a new medium and get out of my comfort zone. But because I had this desire to connect with other artists, I made myself get up and talk to a few people. And this is something that's way out of my comfort zone as an introvert, but it was really helpful because I got to see things from other artists' perspectives. And they talked about why they chose soft colors over vibrant colors, or why they chose thin lines over thick lines, or what they would change if they could. We exchanged compliments and tips, and honestly, I'd never felt more at home than with these strangers I've never even seen. So that was also really what I wanted for the club. I just wanted people to get together and have kind of a safe haven to talk about their shared love of the arts. So all the way home, I was thinking about different ways that I could serve the art community. And I ended up posting a page on my art blog that asked people if they wanted free requests. Because a lot of people online didn't have the money to pay for commissions, but they wanted their characters and ideas to come to life through other people's styles and interpretations. So I picked the first 8 people to contact me, and they each had wildly different characters for me to draw. And sketching different face shapes and poses and clothes really helped me to grow in such a short amount of time, and I didn't think that was very possible. But when they received them, they were super grateful for what I'd done and really delighted to see what I'd done with their own awesome ideas, and it was really cool to give them something that was so personal to each one of them. The next week, I interviewed Mrs. Rossi to see how she gets the spirit of community in her own art classes. She told me that the most important thing was to remind people that everyone has a God-given talent, and that anyone can be an artist if they just learn the basics, which is something that I completely agree with. She also likes to bring her faith into her teaching whenever she can, as, quoting directly from her, "The only kind of art she finds pleasurable to look at is the kind that shows how great God is and his creation, or someone's view of his creation." Discussing with her further, she told me about her experience working for a secular ad agency and how high demand and perfection-oriented they were. She also hated the way that all of their advertising was focused around tempting the viewer into buying something that they didn't even need. But she broke away from that and found a Christian company, and found that they were a lot more understanding and personable. And she realized that her value was not in what she produced, but who she was as a person. And this is real art to me, not just the kind that looks pretty, but also shows you who the artist is as a person. So after talking to Mr. Hackett and Mrs. Rossi, it was time to start the club. But most of the people who were interested in it, including Ashley and myself, had very conflicting schedules because of things like the music or jobs outside of school. So, Ashley and I came up with the idea to extend our club beyond the boundaries of Front Range and created a club online asking people on DeviantArt if they would like to join. And so, the great thing about having an online club is that no one has to be online at the same time. Everyone can post and reply whenever they're able. So it was the perfect compromise. We proposed drawing challenges to each other to get each other past art block and also helped each other do art collaborations where one person would do the line art and then send it to the next person to do the color underneath. It was a really good way to learn new techniques from each other and to push ourselves past our limits. It was an encouraging and accepting environment, and I learned how to reach people through self-expression. Also, from speaking to so many new people at Canvas and Cocktails and online, I learned how to get out of my shell a little bit and become more comfortable talking in front of people. By the time the first speech rolled around, I was able to deliver it with at least half the nervousness I know I would have had otherwise. And I even helped Carly Norton out with her worship night when she asked me to, and we ended up being the only two people on stage, I didn't shy away from the idea of being in front of people. And although this new, unexpected virtue was very important to me, I wanted to keep working on collaboration because my dream job would be to be a book editor. But to be an editor is to be able to collaborate with authors every day and to be able to offer constructive criticism without commandeering their entire piece. So I wanted to understand the editorial process from both sides as both an author and an editor. And I had the perfect opportunity to do this when Mrs. Static offered a memoir writing class. Now, I write a lot, but I'd never written memoir. And memoir comes from real-life personal experience, while what I write is more fictional and rooted in worlds that are completely different from ours. But I remembered what I'd done at Canvas and Cocktails and how I'd tried a new medium and realized it would be a perfect way to expand my horizons with writing. So, the group was very small, but I don't think any of us would have wanted it any other way. And it was kind of awkward at first, but we ended up growing kind of close-knit and it was really intimate. We were required to write three pieces detailing events in our lives, one on family, one on faith, and one on pain. While writing, I mixed in my normal style, describing things like I would in a novel, and I wasn't sure if this was like allowed in memoir writing, but I went for it anyway, and it ended up being the thing that people complimented me on the most, and the thing that made it a little more unique. But when I first brought in my story, I thought that everyone was going to hate it. I was so afraid of what everyone would say. Part of me wanted them to be brutally honest so that I could learn from my mistakes, but the other, much louder part of me wanted everyone to sugarcoat it so that they could save me the pain. But luckily, the comments were a perfect mix of both, and I was able to learn from everything from it and feel encouraged and motivated. I learned from this group how to best approach an author and lead them to something helpful instead of something deconstructive. And memoir writing itself was a worthwhile endeavor, as I learned how to take personal experience and turn it into material and take things that I was familiar with. And the more that I did this, the more human and more well-rounded my characters became in my stories. I also applied what I had learned in editing a few of my friends' papers and stories. And I made sure to pay as much attention to what they did well as what they did that could be improved. And for even more insight into the publishing and editing industries, I went to a conference at Bemis Public Library that was hosted by Len Vlahos, who's now one of my favorite authors and a co-owner of Tattered Cover. He talked about the steps of publication and ended up buying one of his books called The Scar Boys. Now, The Scar Boys is realistic fiction, which is something that I don't read all that often and had been kind of actively avoiding at the time. But the premise made me curious. It was about this boy who had been struck by lightning and disfigured and was searching for friendship through a rock band. And I loved it. It was sad and hilarious and beautiful all at the same time. It was like real life, which is the very thing that I thought shouldn't have such a big role to play in fiction. But it opened my eyes to more genres like mystery and historical fiction and even thrillers, which I loved. And my horizons have been broadened this way, both as a reader and a writer. But besides the wonders of new genres, Len Vlahos also opened my eyes to the idea that most writers, no matter who you are, rewrite their manuscripts up to 3 times before sending it to someone to check. And their manuscripts are never perfect the first time. Every writer I've ever talked to has struggled with this idea of perfectionism. We always want every word, every scene to be perfect the first time, but this isn't how it works. As Anne Lamott said in her book, Bird by Bird, you may have a sort of temporary destination, perhaps a scene that you envision as the climax. So you write toward the scene, but when you get there, or close, you see that because of all you've learned about your characters along the way, it no longer works. One thing I know for sure is that if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. So how do we fight the need to be right the first time? Most writers would say the best way to do this is to write every day and to wait to edit until you're done with the entire piece. This way, perfectionism doesn't hold you back from achieving your goals, but it can help you in the long run when you're trying to work on a cohesive piece. This idea of writing every day, even just 300 words, seems so simple, but it's not. I wanted this to be one of my capstone goals, but it really didn't work out so well. It was almost impossible to carve out time for writing when I had so many tests to study for, so many quizzes, and so many books to read. And even when spring break came, I kept saying things like, oh, like I'm too tired or I have other things to do while binge watching Stranger Things. But however, the few times I did make myself sit down and write, it was the perfect outlet. It was the perfect break from all the chaos. I could take all my stress and turn it into material, all the weight on my shoulders and turn it into ink on the page. And now, I don't write every day, but I have written a lot more since the beginning of the semester, and I am only a few chapters away from finishing a book that I've been working on for more than 2 years. So both the worlds of literature and art seem a little less scary to me now that I know more about them and the roles that I can play within them. This capstone is hard to handle, but it forced me to dive deeper into my passions. It forced me to turn my maybe laters into right nows. And looking back, I'm kind of grateful for that extra push. So for those of you who are juniors, I know that it can seem scary and that it may be hard, but if you're willing to put your all into it, it could be an awesome opportunity. And if you have no idea what you're going to do, just look at the gifts that God has given you. As Proverbs 3:6 says, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Thank you. So does anyone have any questions?
I have one.
Ms. Dickinson?
What does it look like? How do you become a book editor? What kind of
school do you have to do? Well, we have to have at least an English degree. You can have a variety of different degrees, but that's kind of the basic one. And you're supposed to start kind of from as a grammatical editor, kind of going through and making sure every little technical detail's right, but then you kind of work your way up to becoming a plot line editor and kind of go from there, and you kind of have to work up your reputation and kind of shop yourself out to people. And it's funny because people are supposed to be shopping their book out to you, but you have to shop yourself as an editor out to other people, especially if you're not working for a company. But that's kind of what they train you on. So
why do you want to be an editor and not an author?
Because I found that from everyone that I talked to, it's a lot harder to get a substantial job being an author only. So I would like to be an author on the side and have both of that and also develop connections to the editorial industry and be able to do things that way, so I have a stable job and something that I love to do. So, yeah, it seems like a perfect mix.
Thank you.
Esther Taylor and Emma Stone.
Which genre is your favorite now?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know. I've always had a thing for fiction, so mostly, I'd have to say kind of like sometimes like post-apocalyptic type fiction, but also, fantasy type fiction. So, Miss Higginson. Yeah, when I was a kid, I really loved Goosebumps. It sounds funny, but I loved it. The werewolf ones are my favorites. Yeah. The type that I'm writing now, I mean, it started out really, really fictional, but then I kind of started adding more elements of, like, kind of, like, more serious real-life stuff into it. So, I don't know, I'm debating on whether I should keep going with that and keep going more into fantasy, or if I should maybe even split it into two different books and have more of a realistic book and a more fictional book, so. It's kind of hard to explain right now, but the short version is basically that it's about this prince who kind of has to fight his way back to his throne because he's kind of been exiled from his own kingdom. So.